This is a copyrighted work. Unauthorized copying or distribution is a crime punishable by up to 5 years in prison and a fine of $250,000.
Scholastic Audio presents Friend Me by Sheila M. Averbuch. Read by Katy Davis. Chapter 1. I'm beyond hangry by the time I make it upstairs to the weird apartment and its little kitchen. The high school lets out before we do, so my brother's already there, wolfing down cereal, hairy legs stretched out so I can't get by. I drop my phone on the table and pick up the box of Honey Crunch Hoops. Empty. Michael! Michael! He pulls away one ear of his headphones.
You talking to me?
I just opened this! My voice is a screech, which isn't me, but I'm feeling less like me every second.
Michael shrugs like this is beyond his control and keeps munching.
He's never not eating. I swear he's grown taller since we got to America, and it's only been a month. I hurl the box to the floor and stomp it for the recycling. The smiling Honey Crunch Frog crumples and the cardboard pops. I imagine it's Zara Tucci's face.
Okay, I'm sensing some strong feelings about this.
Michael pulls off his headphones and calls over his shoulder.
Jeeves, put Honey Crunch Hoops on my shopping list.
A disc glows blue on the windowsill.
Sure,
chimes a robotic voice. I've added Honey Crunch Hoops to your shopping list. Michael picks up the battered box and drops it into the recycling.
Middle school problems, perchance.
He's being nice, but I hate the world. I fling open the monster fridge, oversized like everything else in this country, and glare at the shelves of strange food. My eyes hunt for something I know from home, some batch bread or Irish cheddar. I would kill for a proper cheese toastie, but have to settle for applesauce.
Chill, Roisin, seriously. Is this about the cereal? I could six them up for you like a penguin.
Michael gurgles retching noises, and I can't help smiling. He flashes me a grin and his freckles wrinkle.
Michael can rock pale and freckled. His hair isn't the frantic red I've been cursed with either. More chestnut. People love him here. I did text you to pick up more, in fairness. I guess you didn't see your phone.
My phone hums and skitters across the table between us, a grating buzz. 4 notifications. 5. Then so many altogether, it's an unbroken zzzz. My stomach falls away. Now that the anger has cooled some, I'm wondering, did I do the right thing? Maybe not. Probably not. Michael leans in and glances at the alerts.
Who's Zara underscore XX underscore OO?
I yank it away before he can see what they're saying.
A friend? I snort into my applesauce.
God almighty, someone take me back in time to when I didn't know who Zara was. I can still see myself on top of the world saying goodbye to everyone in Dublin. Mum asked if I was sad about leaving my friends, but this was what I'd always wanted. To go to the States. Even when Dad hugged us goodbye at the airport, it was only a flash of sadness. The rest was pure excitement. Well, no amount of smiley American TV prepared me for the snake pit of Eastborough Middle. Zara wasn't the only one to mock my accent and clothes, but she was first. It's still bizarre to me that no one wears uniforms and that school clothes are a thing. Mum's taking me shopping in Boston as soon as she can get a Saturday off from her new job. Until then, I'm surviving on a couple of emergency outfits from Target, which I wear a lot. Like, a lot. Zara loves this. Every lunchtime, she sends me a DM on TokTok, a picture she's taken of me, circling my hoodie or leggings, question marks drawn all over it.
Is this the same thing you wore Monday? Maybe in Ireland, people don't change their clothes, but here, it's gross.
Today, though, Zara changed things up. Instead of a DM, she mocked me in front of everyone, and I sort of snapped. 35 days straight of her rubbish. Am I supposed to take that and say nothing? Michael's waiting for me to tell him who Zara is.
He keeps saying I can make friends if I try harder. But I'm not him. My brother is like a log fire everyone wants to be near. I'm more smoke and ash. At least, that's how it seems here. Zara Tucci. I push away the rest of the applesauce. An idiot. Michael nods and grips the headphones at his neck, ready to disappear back to his tunes and homework.
Anything I can do?
He calls to the windowsill, putting on an epic movie trailer voice.
Jeeves, destroy Zara Tucci.
Jeeves apologizes that he doesn't know how to do that yet. I laugh, like Michael knew I would. He smiles and heads down the hall, nearly crashing into one of the sloped ceilings. Our flat is the top floor of a Victorian mansion. Some of the ceilings are slanted nearly to the floor, and there's a mothball smell everywhere, though Mum thinks it could be mouse poison. Brilliant. If I had to brainstorm the least homey home, this would be it. But Michael loves the American weirdness. From day one, he was messing with the ice maker and throwing eggshells and banana skins into the garbage disposal just to hear it scream. He calls back to me from down the hall. Mum texted to say don't forget Whole Foods. Why can't you do it? I yell. But I know why. Studying for SATs. His excuse for everything. He says it like SATs now. They were SATs till we left Ireland, but he's adapting. I change my clothes and grab Mum's Whole Foods card. She keeps hassling me to bring creepy Jeeves along too. Apparently, if I put him onto my phone, he'll guide me right to the lasagna in the shop. He's like an Alexa, but turbo. Mum invented him. But no way is Jeeves going onto my phone. I can imagine him piping up with random comments at school, like he does here sometimes. That's just what I need. Outside, the heat is like a wall. Crazy hot for May, though Mum says anything's possible with Massachusetts weather. I traipse down our hill toward Eastburgh's one shopping street, and before I'm even halfway, sweat pricks under my arms. The soapy smell of lilacs makes me want to gag. I blow out a breath. The problem's not the weather. The problem is me. My phone feels like an unexploded bomb in my pocket. What happened at school replays like a stuttery nightmare in my brain. Getting paired with Zara in art. Sketching her pinched rat face for an hour. And that wasn't even the worst. The teacher made us take a photo of each other to draw from. Thank you, Mr. Morrison, for loading a bullet into Zara's gun. She shot it straight onto Tok Tok for everyone to enjoy. She'd drawn wavy stink lines around my hoodie and added a poll. Vote if you think @Roisin K. Doyle should change her clothes. There were 39 votes, all yes by the time I got onto the bus. And the comments. I sat there reading, wanting to vanish. OMG, yes, she wears the same clothes all the time. Maybe it's an Irish thing, like potatoes. She eats a tuna baked potato every day and it stinks, like that outfit she never washes. That one from Zara. I wanted to kick something. I wash and dry my stuff every day. The gallon of liquid Tide is almost gone. My hands were shaking so hard, I nearly dropped my phone as I climbed our hill home, typing a reply. You won't smell anything after I rip your head off. A few people shot back straight away. OMG, fighting Irish. What are you, a psycho? That one, with the idiot spelling, is hard to forget. There'll be dozens more by now, which is why I'm not going to look. A crowd stands outside the 7-Eleven and I stop short. But when I'm closer, I see it's not 7th graders, it's 9-year-olds. My heart's still running like a rabbit as I pass them and the Goodwill, which is like a charity shop, but without the fun. Mum and I love charity shops. We went straight into Goodwill when we arrived. Never again. The looks people give you. Two ladies stared at us as we left, like we were ready to beg for change. I glared right back. I wanted to tell them Mum works at MIT. Mum was relaxed about it. She's like Michael. A sudden wave of missing Dad surges in my chest. My eyes fog with tears as I head into Whole Foods. Something bangs into me. Ow! A voice whines. Watch it! Oh, brilliant. It's the girl who whispers with Zara. blonde hair, straight as a blade. My arm throbs where I crashed into her. Sorry. I bend to pick up my bag and swipe at my eyes.
What did she do, Mara?
Someone asks behind her. That voice. The plague rat herself. Zara steps out from behind Mara, and my heart starts skipping again. I can't help it. She's a head shorter than me, with black eyes and an Italian tan I'd give anything for. It's a marvel of nature how so much mean was stuffed into that tiny package. Zara glares up at me.
Did you hit her?
She rests a hand on Mara. Are you okay? Mara rubs her shoulder like I dislocated it. I guess it is possible I hurt her. Swimming's given me strong arms and she's mostly bone.
I had something in my eye and didn't see her. I said sorry.
Zara opens her mouth like she's going to make a thing of this, but just hooks her arm through Mara's like she's tugging her close for protection. I saw what you said on my post, you psycho, she hisses. Who knew you were so violent? I walk off to find Mum's lasagna, leaving them by the gallons of apple juice stacked to the ceiling.
The post was a joke,
Zara calls, loud enough for everyone in the place to hear.
That's a thing we have in America?
My jaw clenches so hard, my teeth ache. I will the tower of juice to topple on her, but nothing happens. I grab a container of stew, not what Mum wanted, but I don't care. My eyes sting and there's a weight in my throat. I'm not going to cry. I just want to get out of here. But at the self-checkouts, the stupid till won't read Mum's card.
You all set?
A plump guy in a long apron and Whole Foods cap has appeared beside me. His name tag says Dion, assistant manager. He's barely older than Michael, maybe 18, with a hopeful fluff of mustache. He boops his card and tries again. And now I look like I've stolen the stew because I have to haul it out of the bag. My neck burns as a blush creeps up my chin. I become a huge flaming freckle when I'm embarrassed.
Register's not working so good today, sorry.
Dion looks at the error message.
Oh, card declined. You got another one?
I don't, sorry. I feel the pathetic urge to tell Dion everything. I think he clocks that I'm holding back tears. Heads turn from the other checkouts looking at the girl who can't pay. I will utterly die if the devil twins are watching all this. But they vanished, thankfully.
Hey, are you Irish?
Dion's round face breaks into a grin.
Man, I love Ireland. I want to go. You know what? Beef stew's on the house.
I try to thank him, but the tears are right there. All I can manage is a nod. I rush through the sliding doors, back out the choking heat. I'm still blinking in the hot glare when something lands with a whump in front of me. A Goodwill bag. A tangle of giggles and hushed voices comes from off to my left. Zara with some other Egypts. My stomach tightens. They've bought me a bag of clothes from the Goodwill.
Now you can change your outfit,
Zara shrieks. She sits on a wall with Mara and some other randos. Whoever they are, she's trying to impress them. I kick the bag away and it splits. Looks like a green hoodie.
Wrong color? Sorry.
Zara lilts, trying to mimic my accent. Mara hoots, laughing. I stride by them, past the 7-Eleven toward our hill. Pounding footsteps catch up to me. One of them's following me. I wheel around to face them, fist raised. Are you okay, Roisin? My hand falls to my side. It's not Zara or Mara. It's Lily. Chapter 2. Lily Tanaka. Imagine the maximum amount of beauty a human should be allowed, then double it, then give up because you're not even close. Lily is basically perfect, with a smile that lights the world. It's only when you see her and Zara together that you realize who's the imitation and who's the original. If Lily does a hair thing or wears some perfume her mum brings back from Tokyo, Zara and that whole crowd copy her. She definitely started that cat flick eyeliner thing they all do. It should be so easy to hate her, but it's impossible. Lily's the kind of person who always says hi and asks how you're getting on and remembers it's Roisin, not Roisin. The weirdest thing? Lily was almost my American bestie. Her mother is my mum's boss in her new job. We chatted loads online when I was still in Dublin, laughing about our mother's obsession with robots and creepy AI. But she dropped me as soon as I arrived. Made plans with me, then cancelled. Maybe once Lily saw how weird people think I am here, being friends felt like a bad move. Can't make a bad move when you're queen of the school. Anyway, Lily already has a bestie. Zara. Lily glances behind her. Were they being jerks? I fold my arms, trying to hold myself in. The stew in the Whole Foods bag slung over my back presses cold against me. I try not to look at the other bag on the ground, torn and spilling its hoodie guts. I'm about to tell Lily what Zara did when Nikesh comes out of the 7-Eleven and walks toward us, holding two Diet Cokes.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.